Wait, wait, okay. All right, this is the Cuyahoga County work Cuyahoga County Council work session for Tuesday, June the 26th. Madam Clerk, will you call the roll?
Mr. Schron?
Here.
Ms. Conwell?
Here.
Mr. Jones?
Here.
Ms. Simon?
Here.
Ms. Connolly?
Here.
Mr. Greenspan?
Here.
Mr. Miller?
Here.
Mr. Brady?
Present.
Mr. Germana?
Here.
Mr. Gallagher?
Here.
We have a quorum.
Thank you. We're here for our update on the MedMart, and we have Mr. Applebaum, Mr. Bennett, and I understand Mr. Bennett wants to go first?
Have Mr. Bennett go first.
Okay, all right.
I can talk fast in Enfield since we only have a half hour.
All right, Mr. Bennett, please come forward.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for the invitation to the topping off of the building. I was able to sign the beam, and I put the names of my deceased dog and my two current dogs, and so their names will live in posterity forever on the MedMart beams.
I think I took the pen right after you and signed next to your red dogs as well.
Okay.
Thank you. Well, it's good to see you again. It was on May 8th, so I had been with the Medical Mart for 3 weeks at that point, and introduced myself and what I thought my job was, and gave you some early indications of what struck me and what I was finding. I'm now in my 11th, so it's gone from the third week to the 11th week, and I think that now I can be a bit more specific rather than introducing myself and just bring you up to date on three things. Does it show up on the screen?
It's up there now.
Pardon me?
It's up there now.
Oh, it is. Okay. And I've given the document to everybody, so that hopefully will be convenient. Just a word on the context, oversight, and support bodies. Then a Medical Mart leasing update, always of curiosity about the project. And then convention center meetings update. And here the report is both from me and from Positively Cleveland. And the numbers you'll be seeing, David Gilbert's seen, and David's staff, so you're seeing a consistent picture of where things stand. I've come to appreciate, and I genuinely say this, with the wealth of the oversight and support bodies that are in place to work with on the project. You see them here. With respect to the Cuyahoga County government, we have weekly meetings with the construction and operations reviews subjects with Jeff and his team, and Bonnie Tuin representing the county, and others who would be there. So that is weekly, where there is discussion as to what's happening and problem solving. With regard to yourselves, there was the meeting on May 8th and then today. The Cuyahoga County Medical Mart Advisory Panel, and you see the members there. This was put in place last fall, as I think you know, by the county executive with your support. We had a meeting on May 30th, and we have already scheduled the subsequent three meetings, and you see them here. And then the advisory board to us at MMPI, both companies and ex officio members, and I have talked with each of those companies one-on-one twice since I saw you last, and we've had a meeting on May 18th. And then here are the schedule of reviews going through the fall. So there is a lot of oversight and a lot of, at the same time, support from these various groups, because while pushing us to do our jobs well, they are also asking how to a body, asking how they can be helpful or providing counsel on subjects where we can benefit from it. I thought I would move briefly to just a word or two about the industry advisory board members, because they are the ones who help drive the tenant mix in the Medical Mart in particular. These are the names of the company, so being quite specific as to who they are. They've been in the press a couple of times, but we've added Johnson Controls and Cardinal Health, I think, since we saw you the last time. And if you take the three ex officio members, we have an advisory board actively engaged individually as institutions, and the leaders of many of them as potential tenants in the medical mart as well, as you'll see in just a minute. So moving then from those bodies, and in particular with a focus on the Industry Advisory Board, this was a page that I put together after being, I handed it out at the last council meeting. I used it in every discussion with the press consistently from the third week going forward, and it has held up pretty well. So as a general framework, you have seen this before, and it gave my view back a ways in terms of required characteristics and then some of the program and tenant options that were shaping up. This has, as I say, held up well, but what's more important is the work underway, and I've moved to page 6, to translate those offerings into a strengthened business plan and additional tenants. So how are we doing that? There's a lot of support and staff work that's needed to do it. So we have a project team provided by BioEnterprise with an outside consultant as a leader, as the leader, with BioEnterprise senior staff who are the team members. So we've got a team of about 4 or 5 people working kind of nonstop to push these themes forward and translate them into action and work with the individual companies. It's a 3-phase project tied to those progress reviews you saw a page or so ago. And the scope is inclusive of all those offerings. So everything you saw on that prior page, the team is working on, and the entire facility. But when you shift to the clients, I am the principal client and my team, but the industry advisory board members are involved as clients as well. That's that second set of points on the page. The particular focus with them is on collaborative multi-vendor showrooms, the operating room of the future, the home of the future and home care, and think of stage sets or think of interesting and dynamic spaces, and single vendor showrooms as well, which of them would like to be there for their particular business purposes. They provide overall counsel that's both valuable and appreciated, but it is very clear, and it is very clear that participation in the medical mart as a tenant is presumed. So when we have these one-on-one discussions, I say thank you very much to the people from IBM for your guidance generally on the issues we've posed to you. How are we doing on having a basis for you to participate, which will get you excited? So it works at the two different levels. And that is going quite well. They are enthusiastic about what's possible. It's interesting, the word that rises to the top, as it says on the page here, is collaboration. There's not much of anybody who sees themselves next to a couple of other companies that have the same equipment or the same products slugging it out. What they really want is to show how working together collaborating, they can improve care for patients, reduce costs, and so forth. So collaboration is overwhelmingly the theme. These other words, leading edge and innovative, come up all the time. And they're pretty proud at being involved. And most important to those of you who are business persons, as we in business say, business cases are starting to emerge, and they vary by company, but they're pretty compelling. And they have nothing to do or little to do with being in a place where meetings are coming through and somehow they'll get more customers because of meetings. Kind of the original idea of a mart of having meetings and being dark in between meetings and counting on the meetings to drive things tends not to, it's useful, but tends not to come up anywhere near so much as we need a sales center that we don't have anywhere else and we bring our clients here. Or a very consistent theme is the last one, do sales reps training in collaborative showrooms that aren't available anywhere else in the world. So what they frequently say is, I'm from Stryker, and we have our equipment, and we train people on our equipment, but our reps don't see what's on the ultrasound on the other side, what's on the other side of the Stryker knee coming into it and coming out of it, and boy, would it be valuable if we were able to have that in the medical mart. So there are many business cases that make me quite a bit more optimistic than I was when I saw you 7 weeks ago, because I did not know whether the business cases would be there. I had confidence that energy and hard work would make this a success, but I truly didn't know enough to have conviction about that. So I've kind of moved into, it certainly is by no means home free, but I am, those of us who are very close to it are getting more and more enthusiastic that this is going to work. So getting to what folks are interested in, and I have only two more pages.
And 2 minutes.
Oh, I thought Mr. Applebaum and I had...
We have an agreement. We have a deal. He gets more time than I.
Okay.
Would that be okay?
That's fine.
How about 4 minutes?
You know those red lights that go on the Supreme Court?
Who's flashing the red? This is as much as you know here, other than the names of individual companies, you know everything that anybody involved in this, this is the latest information we could provide. If you look at the bottom, you see, I had mentioned before, there are 17 advisory board members. 8 of those have now committed. It is my strong belief that we'll end up with 15 or so. So if you read those bars across, there are other organizations with negotiated leases that came out of that initial process of letters of intent that were broadly distributed and seeking interest generally, as you read across. So right now we have 14, so 22 negotiated deals. I think some of those are going to find, as they see how this is evolving, that it's not the place for them to be. So some of them will probably fade away or will have a space where several of them could be rather than having their own space. There are then still the 38 letters of intent that were out there, you know, for some months, for a year or so ago. We have none of those reflected in the 22. I'm guessing out of the 38, there probably won't be more than 5 or 6 that will end up meeting our criteria. There's another 7 that are pretty good ones that have come along in the meantime. So I'm guessing there'll be 5 of those. And I think the real estate is now getting so valuable that we're going to go say, who do we want in here, and issue invitations to be in the club. So I am feeling increasingly confident. So you see that 20 at the top that we haven't invited yet, or that we're having early discussions on, it would be my hope that we would end up with about 15 of those. So we might have 60 or so by the time of opening. And the feel of this is it's headed toward valuable real estate that people, it's going to be a good neighborhood that people want to be in. Now, the next question is, well, who are these companies and what are your communications plans? What I'm hoping is that we can get the ones, particularly in the 8, to begin issuing press releases, speaking to the media, letting the community know why they're excited and what they're going to do. That is a company-by-company decision, and as I think I said 7 weeks ago, it's not right for us to send out a list, put them in a position where they get the inquiries until they've said that they are willing to do that. But it's my belief and hope that you will start to see a number of them coming forward and saying what they're going to do. So that's the medical mart. The final one is how about meetings? And this is a report from David Gilbert and myself and our staffs. The booked and confirmed events are as you see here. You see them broken out between the exhibit hall and meeting rooms, that is, that don't use trade shows. And you see the numbers for 2013, which is a pretty short year, so it's really only 4 months or possibly 5, with an event or two, maybe 6, if we are lucky in moving construction along. And then full years in 2014, 2015, and so on. So we have a lot of work to do there, but we're pretty encouraged, particularly if you see the current pipeline. The 10, I probably had 3 people call me today, so the 10 plus of meetings is probably, if we collected them all, more like 25. And the exhibit hall, we've got a pipeline of about 50 different meetings. A couple more come in every day. So it feels pretty good. And one of the things that feels good about it is the room nights. If you were to add the room nights on the bottom, it's about half already. of our commitment in the benchmarks to the county as to what was to be achieved in the first 2 years. So if you add the first 2 years' bookings along the bottom and the room nights, which drives economic impact, that's where the numbers really start to benefit the community. We're feeling a sense of urgency to keep doing this, but there's a lot of interest in Cleveland, and we're feeling pretty good. One more minute on a couple of these. The Ohio Music Education Association left Cleveland after 2006, as they just said the old convention center didn't work for them. They're happy to return, and they're in those numbers for 2015, 2017, and 2019. It's in February. Very nice, as you would guess. 2,000 attendees, 170 exhibiting companies. And while it's officially a state conference, it draws people from outside Ohio. The National Model Railroad Association, it was the first to sign a contract with us, us being MMPI. 2,000 delegates to the convention, 30,000 people come into the convention center to visit all the displays and the shows. We beat Memphis and Calgary to win that one. So, you know, these numbers are just a beginning, but this is where we stand. You know as much now as we do. We're happy to tell you the names that have said we can tell you. The people that I announced the last time who had just signed, and I mentioned everybody's in the community's effort to bring the largest medical meeting ever, we asked if we could let you know who they were, and they requested that we not yet, but they will soon. So that's the sense of things. I feel better grounded than I did 7 weeks ago, and much more optimistic that this is going to fly, particularly in the medical mart that I did when I first met you all.
Thank you, Mr. Bennett. Anybody have any brief questions on them? Will you bring a new life to this project?
Thank you.
Just real quick, I know you can't name the names, but you had eight out of the 15 that are part of your advisory group. So therefore, if we eliminate the three potential local ones, that means at least five are coming from outside the area.
Yeah, we're started. Well, not quite, but we're getting outside ones as well.
Yeah. Well, math has to be.
The media coverage from the event on Friday was really very good nationally. I had somebody call me from Washington, D.C. and said they read about it in the New York Times and wanted to talk to me about it, and it's worked out to be good, and that's nice to have that kind of regard for Cleveland and what people have seen.
And we were lucky. It was a beautiful day. It was just a picture-perfect day.
Wasn't that great?
Yeah.
So. It was terrific. Yeah. Thank you.
All right, Mr. Applebaum.
Let me put the other one up here. So I'm going to do this in like 10 minutes or less. It's going to be a very brief update. The project summary remains the same. A design and construction update to begin with. Number one, our design process is complete. The only thing left to do with any aspect of design is signage. I'm going to conclude this with just a small piece about signage and naming rights. Purchasing is complete. All purchasing has occurred. The only thing left with respect to purchasing is some furniture, fixtures, and equipment. They are in the process right now of identifying and purchasing equipment. To the extent that there are some contingency dollars left at the end of the project, there may be some additional purchasing, but all essential purchasing is now complete. The project is absolutely on time. As a matter of fact, we are exploring whether or not the completion date can be modified somewhat, but the project is on time. We are on schedule for our August 31, 2000 substantial completion date. We see no issues with delivering the project absolutely on time. The project is within budget. We see no issues with respect to the project being delivered within budget. As a matter of fact, as I've reported before, we've already harvested some savings as part of our methodology of doing this. We have points at which Time Turner Construction, if they have not used some of their own contingency, They deliver it back. We've already used $2 million of that for some upgrades, and there will be additional spending from contingency. So not only is the project within budget, but we are actually putting more scope into the project than we originally anticipated. Well, we anticipated the possibility of doing this, but we're using contingency dollars with a controlled method of putting money back in. So we're on time and we're on budget. To date, the total developer cost through May 31st, $245 million has now been put into the various aspects of the project, including consultants. Of that, $212 million is actual construction in place. $21 million was put in place during the month of May alone, and this is the amount that we're putting in place per month is escalating now that we are enclosed. The project is now 60.2% complete. The last time I was here, I think 6 weeks ago, I told you it was 50% complete, so that tells you the rate at which we are progressing. The project exceeds LEED Silver certification criteria, so we are at least on board to get LEED certification on the project. And as you all know, there was a topping out ceremony that occurred on June 22nd, 2012. The topping out ceremony is an old Scandinavian rite. They do say something about no dogs' signatures on the beam, so I have to tell you about that. There's a superstition about that. So here was the scene from the topping out ceremony. A few photographs just to tell you about progress on the project. This is now a current view of Mall C. You can see that Mall C is now totally enclosed. We actually are well along with putting the grass surface back on. The tree pits are going in on the left and right. If you want to know what's going on under, this is the interesting thing. There are now almost twice as many people working on the project as there were in March. If you looked at the project in March, you'd see all this activity. Now you don't see a lot of activity because people are working below. So if you looked beneath Mall C, you would see a tremendous amount of activity. This is actually a scene in the ballroom area. It's after hours. You don't have many work persons there, but a lot of mechanical equipment going in place, ductwork, just a tremendous amount of work in the lower level. This is Mall B. You now, and you saw this at the topping out, you now see the sweep going up to the lakeside entrance. Tremendous amount of work going on there. This is the type of activity. Now, this is on the south side of the exhibit hall, but you can see the type of activity going on in the exhibit hall itself. Once again, tremendous amount of infill work, mechanical work, and other work going on down below. The Medical Mart atrium, if you were looking at it today, you would see all the scaffolding in place as they work inside the atrium of the Medical Mart. You saw at the topping out ceremony all the that we also topped out the last piece of precast there, so that's all in place. A few words about contracting and staffing. This is where we are right now in the manpower loading chart. They are in May, 591, the average workforce on that project was 591 individuals, workers. And by contrast, when I reported at the end of March, there were 394 people on the site. So we haven't doubled, but we've increased by like 70%. So we're getting up to the peak manpower right at the central portion of the project. We estimate there'll be about 650 people on the site next month. A large economic impact, large payroll right now as we continue on with the project. In terms of our inclusion goals, 25% SBE goal, we are currently at over 30%. We've stayed consistently there. 147 committed subcontractors, of which 54 have been hired by the respective prime contractors for the first time. That number is actually up a little bit as we get toward the final numbers here. County residency, this has really jumped up. We have never been over 50%. We're now at 51%. 51% of the people working on this project, and I'll show you the man hours, are residents of Cuyahoga County. About 20% are residents of the city. And you can't read this, but I will tell you what this tells you is that as of the end of May, there were over 632,000 man hours on the project, of which more than 51% or 323,000 from the county. This also demonstrates that 21% of the workforce are minorities and 5% are women. So that gives you a little bit of the flavor of the workforce. In my remaining 3 minutes, I just skipped some slides, a couple process developments. What are we doing right now, aside from all the normal, all the construction? We're very engaged in the construction process, but now we're starting to prepare for closeout and commissioning. We're starting to think through what we have to do to close out the project, to commission the project, to get it going. We are commencing our operational phase transition planning behind the scenes. We had our first big meeting between the county and MMPI where we went through the checklist of everything that we have to start doing from an operations point of view. So we had a kickoff session, as Jim mentioned. We're now in regular weekly meetings, and half the meeting is now deals with forecasting operational phase issues as well as completing construction issues. We're developing a management and reporting structure for all that, for all the commitments that MMPI has. MMPI is already commenced outreach, so they had their first outreach event, I believe, last night for small businesses who now want to engage in the operational phase, the various contracts of people that have to operate in the facility. There's going to be over 50 contracts that will be operational phase contracts. We have committed as the county, even though it's MMPI who is in the lead on that, we have committed as the county to put a link on our website because people are not really going to know where to find, you know, where to go. They'll think it's the county. So we'll put a link on our website that takes them back to the operation that MMPI has in place to meet the SBE commitments. We're doing a series of other things, exploring public art opportunities right now. One thing I did want to come back to, because there's some confusion about this, is exterior signage and naming rights. Right now, we do have the right, and we have been working with the city and others to think about harvesting of naming rights. There are actually four categories of naming rights available on this project: naming the Medical Martin Convention Center, naming malls B and C, naming specific venues on the mall, and naming specific venues within the Medical Mart and Convention Center. All the revenue from naming rights, one way or the other, and yes, we can't, you could buy this name, but it's going to cost you a lot of money. All the revenue for naming rights stays in the project one way or the other. It either stays in the project on the Convention Center side for capital improvement fund, or for maintenance or operations, or with respect to malls B and C, it stays in the project with respect to capital improvement or maintaining the malls. There's a sharing arrangement, but all revenues stay within the project one way or the other. That's why the county and the city are going to coordinate efforts to get these naming rights taken care of. We will take the lead, but we have a partner in the city in getting this naming rights process taken care of. Ultimately, there will be an RFP issued through the county for a naming rights consultant that will work with our project team, and we will get that taken care of. The one thing I want to point out is that right now we're talking about signage, and you may have seen some depictions of entrance signage. For example, here's where an entrance sign with whatever name would be on the Ontario Street entrance. Here's where the entrance sign would be on the Lakeside entrance. Here's where an entrance sign would be at St. Clair. Those are entrance signs. Those are not the naming right signs. Eventually, if we are so fortunate as to sell a naming right, that would be more of a monumental signage, whether it's something up on the Medical Mart or standalone monumental side, that'll be paid for with the naming rights revenue, because anyone who sells the naming rights wants more of a kick than these entrance signs. So don't confuse the entrance signs with the eventual naming rights signs and those rights. You'll hear more about that as we go forward. The Cleveland Medical Martin Convention Center is the name of the project. It is not necessarily the name that will be given to the buildings, the name that will be given to the malls. That is part of our next process. That's all I have time for. So and that is the shortest presentation I think I'll ever give you. But next time we'll get into the budget in detail. I was going to do that this time. We didn't have time, but we're going to do an in-depth view of the budget next time.
All right, very concise. Any questions?
I just have one.
Ms. Kawa?
When I pass the building, what is that metal thing coming out? I thought the park was going to be flat on the south end. The metal high beam, it looks like it's going to be a bridge, but I know it's not.
You're talking about on the north, on Lakeside Avenue?
Mm-hmm.
So the north end, south of Lakeside, that is actually, so what occurs, I'll show you the picture. What you're looking at, well, it's not a very good picture. On Lakeside Avenue, what happens is the green roof, which we think, by the way, may be the biggest or one of the two largest green roofs in the United States for this kind of facility. The green roof, ultimately, it slopes upward. That's all going to be green on top of there, so that it forms. So what you're seeing right there That's the top of the green roof. So on Lakeside, it forms the entrance. You can actually walk up the green slope. You'll be on top, looking north toward the lake. And that gives you the ability to have the entrance. There's a very large area down below. It's almost 60 feet. So that's the very large, you know, the north side of the meeting halls down below. So that is the grass sweep that goes up. It forms the promenade, so you can look out north at the lake. It forms the entrance down below, and it's all the green roof. That's part of the, that's sort of the iconic design, so that at the north side of Mall C, you have all glass that you could look out toward the lake, and there's natural light that comes down. At the north side of Mall B, I should say, and then, of course, at Mall C on the north side, you also at the ballroom have a glass promenade to look out at the lake. I will send you some, I can send you some pictures that, that show you that more clearly.
Mr. Miller?
To Mr. Applebaum, when you say that any money from the naming rights stays with the project, what does that mean in terms of what that money could be used for?
To Mr. Miller, Chair, to Mr. Miller, there are actually four naming rights opportunities. Let me explain in each case what happens. The county has the right to name the Medical Mart and Convention Center. If the county names the Medical Mart and Convention Center, the dollars which are obtained for that can be used for three things, or half of the dollars can be used for three things. Either for additional capital improvement on the Medical Mart and Convention Center, or for maintenance. It could be for an existing improvement, for operations, or future capital repairs. So it has to go into an escrow account. Half of the money goes to the city, but they must use it either for improving, maintaining, or capital repairs to the malls. If the name, the city has the right to name the surface, because they have the easement. They have the right to actually name the malls, Malls B and C. Half of the money comes back to the county to be put back into, for use for the project, either for capital improvement or maintenance. Half the money, the city's half stays, but has to be used on the malls. They can't bring it and put it back into their general fund. If specific venues are named, by way of example, you've heard about the fact that there is the Group Plan Commission that will be working in conjunction with this. We believe that under their agreement with the city, the Group Plan Commission can name an individual venue, so they may want to name a fountain. That money has to be utilized for the improvement and ultimately operations and maintenance. So that naming rights money, the way it was designed and the way that we split the deal way back when with the city, they wanted part of the revenue. That was in the original development agreement, actually. When I came in and negotiated this, we said, okay, you can have half the revenue. We won't fight you on that because we already made the deal, but only if it's put back, only if you use it to maintain the malls and maintain the project or make capital improvements to the project.
Any other questions? Thank you, Mr. Applebaum. We will get back with you probably another 6 weeks or so, probably maybe around the 1st of August or so.
That'll be great.
We'll get back with you next couple of days.
We'll probably have a lot of developments between then and now and then, so okay. I think that'll be significant time to do it.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
All right, is there any other miscellaneous business for this committee of the whole? Any public comment? Anyone signed in for public comment?
No, Madam President, no one signed in.
All right. Motion to adjourn the work session.
So move.
All right, so adjourn. And do we need to take a break or can we go straight into the council meeting?
Go ahead.
Okay. All right, we'll go.